All right, our next question is, what upcoming research are you excited about?
I think there's two categories. The stuff we know that's upcoming and the stuff that we don't know, but we're going to be thrilled to see.
Yeah. So. I think, so when we started this trial in 2015, we set it up as only a two-year-long intervention. And very quickly we were like, man, what happens after that point? Mm-hmm. And we've been very fortunate that we were able to extend this trial to 5 years. And I think I'm really excited about this because a lot of time the criticism that low-carb nutrition gets is that, you know, where's the long-term evidence and the long-term data on what impact your intervention has? So I think, you know, there are some great studies that are in the research now that are at the two-year mark in terms of what low-carb nutrition can do for people with type 2 diabetes. But I think we're going to get a really unique opportunity to look at what happens at years 3, 4, and 5. And in all of that data that's collected, I think we're going to have, and plus we talked about having ketones as a marker of adherence. Mm. We're going to have a lot of really unique and interesting relationships that we're going to be able to explore with that data in terms of outcomes.
Yeah. Again, being kind of the old man here and thinking long term of how things have changed. We still get the criticism that nobody can stay on this kind of diet long term. So I wouldn't ever get funding to do a 5-year study unless we prove that a lot of people can actually do this for 5 years. Yeah. And right now we have close to 300 people who are still active in our intervention coming up towards the 2-year mark.
Yep.
I probably shouldn't be allowed to say that. The other exciting thing is, as I mentioned, there are other people who realize this is a fruitful area for research, not just looking at outcomes, but figuring out why these things happen.
Yeah.
And we now know that beta-hydroxybutyrate is a gene signaling, what we call epigenetic signal, that alters how our genes work. Mm-hmm. So if you're born with a bad gene, but ketones turn it off, it's like not being born with a bad gene. And there are people with much more sophisticated knowledge of gene regulation than I will ever have who are engaging this research, this area of research now.
Yeah.
And then my colleague and friend and co-author, Dr. Jeff Volek, is running, I mentioned the study on a group of people for 3 months at Ohio State University looking at both physical and psychological resilience. They're mm-hmm. doing the study in ROTC students, and only the military is allowed to put people under stress on purpose. I won't say they're out in the firing range having machine gun bullets going overhead, but they're actually studying not just, but can people do vigorous physical tasks, but, what's their mental resilience under stress?
Sure.
And that's being studied. And Jeff is also doing an early pilot study with a ketogenic diet in patients with cancer, working with the oncologists there. And I think that's a very important area of research around the regulation of cell growth, abnormal cell growth.
Yeah.
And again, it's an area where the ketones aren't just a fuel. The ketones signal genes, and that may have a role to play, not as a miracle cure, but potentially as a very potent adjunct for treating certain kinds of cancer.
Yeah, and from a very practical implementation perspective, how much ketones do we need?
Mm-hmm.
How many do we need? What's the concentration that we need to actually elicit the genotype effects that we want to see, the epigenetic effects? So it's, how much do we need? How long does that need to be maintained? How long are those epigenetic changes maintained?
Yep.
There's a lot to do in terms of understanding what the mechanisms are behind this and how much of a signal you need to actually get those changes.
Yep.
And there's a lot of really interesting applications of a ketogenic diet in the literature now too, with cluster headaches and depression, and it's been in seizure literature for years. So I think there's a lot of interesting things coming.
Research being done with dementia and people doing imaging of the human brain in people with early Alzheimer's, and they show that the early Alzheimer's brain, long before there are major symptoms, there are parts of the brain that just aren't burning glucose.
Mm-hmm.
And when you give the brain ketones, you can see those cells light up, become more active when you offer them ketones as a fuel. Again, the future is promising. No
exciting
guarantees
too.
But
No, we'll learn a lot.
We'll be able to come back and talk about this more later.